Good morning. We want to welcome you here to First Baptist Church of Lloyd. And we are here on the last Sunday of the year. So it's kind of interesting how it's worked out here, the December 31st, New Year's Eve. If you were with us on Wednesday night and you've been keeping count, we are now on the seventh day of Christmas. So not sure what the gift is on seventh day of Christmas, but make sure you got that, or just leave the gold rings and don't worry about all those birds and stuff, you know, that type of thing. But if you missed that out, well, we were talking about unwrapping Christmas. We finished it up Wednesday night. Wednesday night, Pastor is going to be starting a new series, so you want to come and join us for that. Sign up for the meal in back so we have an idea of how many to cook for. And then again, Wednesday night services, again, youth, children, and the adults in the fellowship hall with Pastor Jared starting a new series. And we want to wish you a happy new year, however you celebrate tomorrow, whatever food items are tradition for you on that New Year's Day. Go ahead and enjoy those. If you want to go ahead and get your January planned out, go ahead and grab a calendar. You don't have to look at it today or tomorrow. Put that away until Tuesday. But in the new year, go ahead and look at the calendar. Start planning for the things that the church is involved with. One of the things is we'd like to do at the beginning of each year is do a lot of planning and get togethering. And we can't do any planning without eating. So you will notice there is a series of lunches going on. Now, I'm not saying that you're invited to all of those lunches, but they do provide it so that, again, if you're interested in helping out in that area of the church, you are welcome to come, have a lunch, get the information you need to decide whether that's your area of ministry. So you will see we have a hostess committee lunch next Sunday. So again, the hostess committee is the one responsible for all these wonderful meals. So if you want to add to that and be available on Wednesdays and the special activities of the day, they actually also are over some of the bigger events. So if you, again, that is right up your alley, come and join them. Join the hostess committee and get involved with that. And then in a couple of weeks, we have first impressions. That's the orange shirts you see, the greeters, the welcomers, that type of thing. They are always looking for new people, especially those extroverts that love shaking hands and greeting people and welcoming them in and stuff. So you can come to that luncheon and see about joining them and how to get one of those great orange shirts and stuff. And then the counting committee. If you've ever noticed, there's a couple of people always every service that they come from the back and you think, oh, they're going to sit right up front, but then they don't. They disappear into the back and then it's like, well, what's that about? And then about 15 minutes or so, sometimes even when we're singing or preaching, they come out again. Well, that's counting committee. We have the donation boxes out front that people leave things in. Somebody's got to collect that. Somebody's got to count it. So they're going to have a luncheon again. And again, I'm sure they would be willing to, if you want to be added to that group of team that takes care of that great responsibility, they would be willing to do that. So again, January is all about those new beginnings and getting things organized for the church year. And so we want you to join us with that, as well as all of the normal activities. Sunday school is going great. We made it halfway through chapter 10. We hit up on a crescendo again. It snuck up on me, but it's so great because it's talking about God's salvation. I want you to join us, get in with those crescendos that we find in Romans as we finish off the next few chapters over the next couple of months. But let's go to the Lord in prayer now, and we will get started with our new year. He's getting ready. Father God, we want to thank you. We praise you as we come to you and we get to celebrate on the eve of a new year. Lord, we know that you can see all of 2024 laid out before you right now. You know what is going to happen every day of this new year. And Lord, we can rest and celebrate and enjoy you today because you are Lord of 2024. Nothing that happens in that year is going to surprise you. And you will take us and see us through just as you saw us through 2023. And so, Father God, we can testify and we can praise and we can join in celebration with all that you're going to do in this new year. We thank you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. And as I was praying, I remembered, I forgot again, but I won't forget. We did raise over $2,000 as a church for the Lighthouse Girls. That added to what all the other churches were doing. And we can praise the Lord this morning. They met their goal, which was $100,000. That's impressive. But now they are ready for the new year as well. Thank you.
Good morning. How is everybody on this beautiful, cold morning? We'd like you please to all stand with us. And our scripture this morning is Isaiah 49:13. Sing for joy, O heavens. Rejoice, O earth. Burst into song, O mountains. For the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on them in their suffering.
Keep while you whisper. Ready? Just making sure I'm ready. That's why I was asking.
Hear the voice of love that's calling. There's a chair that waits for you, and a friend who understands everything you're going through. But you keep standing at a distance in the shadow of your shame. But there's a light of hope that's shining. Won't you come and take your place and bring it all to the table? It's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. He can see the weight you carry, fears that hold your heart. But through the cross you've been forgiven. You're accepted as you are. So bring it all to the table. It's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your trials, all your worries and your burdens, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. Oh, come on in, take your place. There's no one he's turned away. All you sinners, all you saints, come right in and find your grace. Come on in, take your place. There's no one he's turned away. All you sinners, all you saints, come right in and find your grace. And bring it all to the table. There's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your trials, all your worries and your burdens, there's a Savior and he calls. So bring it all to the table.
Maybe I should ask if I'm ready. Let's bring everything to the table. What a great message this morning. And I needed it. Good morning, everybody. Listen, some of y'all know that I love, if I could, to embarrass people like crazy. I don't get an opportunity much, but this morning to get started, I actually have just a brief opportunity to do that. See, a church our size, not all of you may know this individual that I'm going to truly embarrass if I can, but Paulette has been not just our pianist for years, but she's been our treasurer for, now that we figured out, it's over 20 at this point. And our nominating committee has tasked some other individuals to take care of some things, and she's heading in a different ministry in a different way. But I thought this would go just flawless with our message this morning out of Matthew 25. But as a church, we have a little token of our appreciation. Come on and say hello in front of the camera. Hello, YouTube land. Here she is.
For over 20 years, our church wants to give great gratitude for all you've done. Now, many people know how many weekends she has taken up, off days, and I think she did some finances for us in New Mexico when she was on vacation, just to give you an idea. But with great thanksgiving, let's pray over Paulette and Billy, and let's get started with our message. Would you join me in prayer? Father in heaven, we love you, and we thank you for Paulette and all that she's done. From our church family to theirs, may you bless them this year of 2024 coming up. In Jesus' name, amen.
Love you.
Okay. The other night, I wanted to share part of my Christmas with you all today. I've used this section of Matthew 25 in some other messages. I've used it in other situations, but I've never had the ability to preach through its entirety. Here we go. This area of Scripture the other night, we were playing games together as a family. We were playing a board game. Now, it doesn't matter the name of the game because they're pretty much all the same in the context that it's either total world domination or you got to bankrupt your opponent, right? And so in this, we're playing this game. Now, if I'm vulnerable just for a moment, you have to understand some things. I don't always have to win, but there are certain games I refuse to lose. And maybe you can relate to that. Now, also, I have to be transparent to say this. When my children were much younger, I did not play a lot of games with them. Sometimes it was due to scheduling conflicts. Mostly it was due to the fact that my children, and maybe yours, can take a 20-minute game and make it last 3-4 hours long. And my sanity did not have enough to deal with at that juncture, so we would conveniently do other things. Let's go outside. Let's run. Yes, you run real fast. Keep going, right? And so this is what happened. But lately, we've been playing board games instead of driving me crazy. I've been enjoying it. So let me paint the scene. The four of us are playing. Each of us have our own style. One style was completely aggressive. It was bent on the roll of the dice. Everything was all in. Go, go, go. The other two played a mixture. One foot in defense, another foot in offense, and then there was one of us that was completely defensive. They hunkered down, they built from within. The idea was just don't lose any ground or what have you. And so then it occurred to me as we were playing through this scenario that if you'd think alongside of this, I imagine in this room, whether you like games or not, you probably fit into one of those categories. You're either all go, 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 and the risks ahead, let's just make it happen. But then in some of you, in your day-to-day, you're just hoping if I can give a little, gain a little, whatever it means, or for some, it's all defense, hunker down. What a terrible, terrible 2023. I don't want to duplicate that, so let's just ease slowly into 2024 in hopes that no one will notice. I'm not sure that we fully understand then in that context of those scenarios what life is like. And I don't just mean the board game. So today, as we get started out of Matthew 25, I set the table for all of us by suggesting this thought that today's message will be one of the most significant New Year's messages that I've ever prepared. And now it's time to deliver it. Would you join with me? Because we have a few people who are sick and they're not feeling good. I'm asking that we pray together as a group. Would you bow your heads and then we're going to do Matthew 25. Father in heaven, we have some folks in our church who aren't feeling well. They have come from hospitals. They have come from procedures. They're even at home trying to recuperate. And as a church, we're pray a blessing on them. And so, God, we ask that fear not overtake them and that you give energy to their families. But, Lord, as we get into your word this morning, I ask that you change us from the inside out with thanksgiving heading into the possibility of a brand new year. We pray that in the name of Jesus. Amen. By the way, if you're curious which family member was what, I'll just tell you later. Jesus said heaven is like, out of Matthew 25:14. For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country, who called his own servants, delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, to the other 2, and the other 1, to each according to his own ability. And immediately he went on a journey. Then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them, made another 5 talents. Likewise, he had received 2, gained 2 more also. But he had received 1, went and dug into the ground and hid his Lord's money. Now, as we get started looking deeper at this section of Scripture, I want to ask you, how many friends do you have that you would entrust them with money, you'd give them money to invest for you? How many friends do you have that you could count on to increase your portfolio? And when you narrow down that list, and for some of you, you've got like 1, maybe, right? Well, y'all are a quiet crowd in 23. Maybe you got none, but here's the scenario. I wonder if you do have a small group of friends, would you all give them the same exact amount? In other words, everybody gets the same. Good luck, let's see what you do with it. Or because they have different personalities or different abilities, that maybe you would give a little bit more to some, a little bit less to others. See, that leads to that first point that you have for you today, is that God gives according to your ability. So what's God's kingdom like? God is traveling far, not just to reach the lost, but to meet with the saved. He meets with us when we want Him. He's never left you. So when you pray a prayer, and many of us have, "Dear Jesus, be with me," He's with you. The question is, do you want Him? And so then what happens is, He's coming to reach His own servants, and it's clear in this parable that the man divided money. Now, a talent, for those of you who are studiers, is about worth 20 years of wages. 20 years. And so when you look at this and you think, well, he just gave him 5 cents. That is not the case. 20 years equals to 1 talent. Now, he based it on what he believed each one could handle. So this man with much ability was given 5 talents. The man with what we might call average ability, a talent in this context, he gave him 2. And so then one with minimum ability, he gave 1. And right now, you're probably thinking, well, I don't want to be a 1. Please stay with me. Please stay with me and don't look at it that way. And here's why. See, the importance of this is this. If 5 talents were given to a person who had minimum ability, then he would be destroyed by the weight of responsibility. So when somebody says, God will never give you more than you can handle, liar. There's a lot in life I can't handle. But God would never call us to do His will in an area where we will fail immediately. And that is a big difference. And so for some of you who have been tasked next year, 2024, and said, I want you to do something for the Lord. He just laid it on my heart. Would you do this? Just the fact that you're being asked probably means you need to go into prayer about doing it. You need to ask the Lord's will, to seek His guidance, because He will never call you to do something that would ultimately embarrass His name. Also, it also means this. If only 1 talent was given to someone with great ability, then you would be disgraced and humiliated. Some of you might have even felt that at work or at school. Somebody came along to you and said, hey, I need you to be on the decorating committee, we just need you to be the person who buys the tape. And you would look at them and go, do you not know I run this store? Do you not know that I run this school? Do you not know that I have all... You would be insulted if somebody asked you to do something small when you think you're significantly more. Which also means this, that when God calls you to a task, it was designed for you to do His will. And He's never going to ask you to do something that 1,000 others could do. But spreading the gospel is different. All of us are called to spread the gospel. But not all of us are called, as we even mentioned just a moment ago, to be the treasurer. Not all of us are qualified screen, audio, technician people. You know why I'm standing behind this pulpit? because they wouldn't let me in the booth. Amen. You see, not all of us can do certain things. In this parable, the talents the man gave represents the idea that God gives us opportunities to use our abilities, which means that God's going to assign work to you this year. And you're thinking, well, good, it's just 2023. Guys, I'm already into 2024. Y'all ready, everybody? Here's why. Since the idea of money is coming up in Scripture, I didn't want 2023 to pass you by with only two messages on money. You're welcome, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. I'm sorry, in my notes, that had a little bit of humor. It said something about ha-ha. Let me back that up. You ready, everybody? I am going to talk about money, but I'm going to talk about your marriages and your work today, too. Amen. Let's have some fun. So here it goes. I asked one of our church members, since we're heading into this concept of talents and what all that might mean, they used to serve in the financial world, if the following statements I were going to make was going to be true. Here it is about money. You ready? Every investment involves a level of risk. Every investment involves a level of risk. So if somebody says there is no risk involved, run. Don't walk. Leave. Because you're about to just get absolutely robbed. Okay, everybody? So, when financial planners sit down and begin a relationship with a new client, one of the key factors they find out in this initial interview process is risk tolerance. Are they conservative? Will you stay up all night long if a new president gets elected? Or if the stock market takes a dip? If the housing crisis, are you going to quit eating because somebody left an oil ship in the middle of the ocean for a day longer? Now, maybe the answer for you is somewhere in the diverse mix. You want a little bit of risk and a lot of bit of reward, and so you try to have a little balance in your life. The truth is, this is when it comes to investing money, it ought to be something that you would need to pray and ask God for His leadership. But in this area, the next statement that is true is this. Trusting somebody with our finances will always be a huge deal, especially when everything is dependent upon the person making the right calls at the right time for the best investment for your return. Thus ends the money part of the sermon. That is the quickest money thing you've ever given. Come on, y'all. I just want to make sure we're there, because here's why. You ready? That seems pretty simple, doesn't it? With your friends that you thought about earlier, would you give one of them $10,000 to invest for you? Another friend, would you give them $1,000? Would you give them $100? You see, if you can answer honestly these types of questions, then it would put every relationship you have in its proper perspective, because if you don't trust them with your wallet, then do you trust them with your life? You see, let's look at the spiritual investments. You say this morning, you know, I don't understand. I trust God. I do. I trust Him. But I just don't understand why I seem to be stuck in the job that I have. I can do so much more. Or what about relationships? Why are they always failing? They just don't seem to work out for me. I just keep being single for one reason or another. Or you say, I'm broke. This Christmas about put us out. I asked God to send me more money. I asked Him for even better jobs, opportunities, whatever it might be. But He hasn't given it. Aren't I part of that too? Aren't I part of that, you know, five guy? What was it in my life? And if I asked you which one you were in that parable, if you invested your money with a friend who supposedly knew what they were doing in the investment world, and in 6 months after you invested with them, you contacted your friend to check on your progress, to see how you're doing, and your friend said, yeah, here's the deal, I couldn't handle the risk. I didn't want to lose you as a friend. I didn't want to disappoint you. So I dug a hole in the ground. I put your money in it. But don't worry. The good news is I know where exactly every single cent you gave me, I can give it right back. And so I ask you, wouldn't that be useless? I mean, I could have done that. I'm good at hiding stuff and not knowing where it is. You know how I know that? Try to clean your house. I didn't know I still had that. So you could always bury your own stuff, but if you had a friend do that to you, wouldn't that be awfully disappointing? So listen, church, as I head to this very next point, if you're the third servant, if you're the one who doesn't like the risk, who gets a little intimidated, stay with me. What makes you think you're ready for a brand new job when the truth is you might be in a situation where pressure is going to be on you? What makes you think you're ready for a relationship when you don't take the risks to invest in the friendships you have? What makes you think you're ready for a ton of money when you haven't given God what He required, which is your life? And you won't give a dollar, $500. See, don't you understand? I'm not talking about those individuals that have some illnesses and they've had a tough year. I'm not talking about those individuals who have struggled and limped along and life has hit them like a 2x4. What I'm asking you all this morning is, with the calling of God on your life, what is it that you've done to invest it? What is it that you've done to take a few risks? Here's the scenario. When it comes before all of this message this morning, I had this thought that some of you might be a little anxious about this sermon. That maybe hearing this sermon, some of you might be under the impression I need to be afraid of God. Now, the fear of God is not a bad thing. There's God and then there's me, and we're not in the same playing field. He is powerful, we are not. But because of His grace and His mercy, what you need to understand is that I'm not teaching you to be afraid of Him in the context that you don't talk to Him, reach out to Him. I'm telling you, though, this important message, that God will not give you the blessing you seek when you bury your ability in the ground. The reason we don't need to be afraid of the Lord in the service is because of verse 19 and on. What did the master do when he came back after he was traveling? Here's what it says. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and he settled the accounts with them. I like that long time. Jesus said he'd be back soon. Now, that could be 5 minutes or it could be over 2,000 years. Wouldn't you agree with that? And so here's this thought. You ready? After a long time, see, God is going to call you to a service and He's going to come and settle up with you when you're ready. Here's the beauty part about death. You ready, everybody? Here it is. Don't miss it. You won't die until He's ready to settle up with you. I'm going to say that again. I thought I was going to get more of a gratitude for the Lord. Let's call it that. You ready? You won't die until God is ready to settle up with you. That's a little bit better. And you know why? Because that means you don't have to live in fear. Some of us work in an environment that we kind of take it easy a little bit until the boss comes around. And the boss comes around and we're really good at looking really busy. Students, listen to me. Same goes for you. You slack off until the teacher looks at you, and then all of a sudden, I better start doing what I'm supposed to be doing. Right, everybody? I think some of us actually treat God the same way. We act like He's not seeing us or noticing the things we do, but we come into the sanctuary. We go to a conference. We do something in which we show up, and we go, okay, God's looking at me. It's time to really get right now. Me and Jesus, we're like this until I get home. See, after a long time, the master comes. And so this Lord of the servants, he came and settled accounts with them. And so he who had received 5 talents came and he brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered me 5 talents. Look, I've gained 5 more talents beside them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I'll make you a ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. He also, who had received 2 talents, came and said, Lord, you delivered me 2 talents. Look, I've gained 2 more talents beside them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. See, when we serve the Lord, We don't have to be afraid because why? God is looking forward to the celebrating process. He's looking forward to celebrating. I think we ought to camp out on that for a little while. We often come into the sanctuary and we spend a few moments going, okay, I blew it this last week. And here's the last day of 2023. Some of us came into the sanctuary today going, I blew 2023. I am really looking forward to 2024. This whole next year, it's me and Jesus all the time. It's open like Waffle House, okay? And so the idea is that you come into this environment and you say, I need to be right. I need to be forgiven. I need to do this. You say sorry to everybody. I certainly understand it. But what you need to consider is this thought, that when you come into a house of prayer like this, part of your prayer life ought to be, dear Jesus, let's celebrate. You gave me this little thing in my life, and look what you did with it. You gave me this moment, and you filled my life with joy. There's a song I heard this week, and I'm thankful for it. There are moments in which God wants to celebrate, and you have to believe that, because I like to laugh, and God created laughter. Wouldn't you agree? I like to cheer. Yesterday was a hard cheer day for certain teams. But the Falcons did win 7 games this year, so praise God. All right. You see, you need to understand that God loves to cheer. And I'm telling you, every single one of those guys that took a field, boy, we got to cheer. Every person in the choir, we got to cheer. The people that are serving the Lord in certain positions next year at Lloyd, we ought to cheer. Because it's not just cheer them totally, it's cheering what God is doing in them. Listen, we have a wonderful faith family. But I've been a part of some churches where some of the most critical individuals are Christian believers. Did you notice in Scripture where it says the Lord entertained this moment with the guy? He says, you gave me 5, I'm bringing 5 back. Did you notice that section in Scripture where he goes, that's all? Come on, dads. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? Where the guy who had 2 and he says, Lord, you gave me 2, I'm bringing 2. You couldn't have done better. You mean that's the best you could offer? You know why that's not in Scripture? Because that's not how God operates. It's not when we greet Him in heaven and enter into a moment of joy where Jesus goes, here's the deal, you could have done just a lot more. Welcome to heaven. It's going to be perfect. But let's be honest, you just barely made it. It's not anything like that. Because why? God wants to celebrate. Why do you think we're being invited to a wedding feast? Our name is actually reserved. We had not just have a seat at the table. We have a moment in which we're going to participate. It's one thing to be invited but asked to stand near the bathroom. It's another thing to be invited and have a place at the table in which we celebrate and make merry. I love the idea of a good party. And this is what the Lord shows up for. And so if you read the study notes of your Bible, what the Bible tends to call these servants is faithful and unfaithful. Now, in verses 21 and verses 23, they have an identical response. Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I'm going to make you faithful in a whole lot more. And so here it is. He says, I'm giving you these responsibilities. I'm going to give you more. Let's celebrate. God likes to celebrate effort as well as results. I have a confession. In my life, now whether it was my upbringing, whether it was my teachers, coaches, maybe it's my DNA, I am a results-driven individual. Is it clean? I bet it could be cleaner. You made a B? What about an A? You did this? Couldn't you push it? You ever seen those guys in FSU lift weights? Have you ever seen the strength coach? They're literally over there yelling, "Give me one more." And I believe that for many of us in life, we tend to think that results is all that God is committed to celebrating. You need to understand that when He was praising these individuals, He never praised them for the result when it comes to the amount. He praised them for the result in which they took what He gave and they came back with more. He gave the same compliment, the same reward went to both. You ready, everybody? When you go to heaven, it's not like somebody is going to be staying in the biggest, most impressive mansion in the entire world, and then Pastor Jared or you gets an outhouse. When you go to heaven, there's not this huge tier in which you made it barely and your street of gold looks a little more bronze than somebody else's. That's not how that works. When you go to heaven, it is because of Jesus and His sacrifice and grace alone, which means that when you show up, it's well done. And so because of that, we need to show people this side of eternity what the kingdom of heaven is going to be like. You see, what's God celebrating? He's celebrating faith. He's celebrating the faithful servants who took what He had to offer. And so because of that, I could probably make an entire sermon out of just that, but I won't. Because all I want you to see is how amazing God is and how He rewards and He celebrates. So how does God like to celebrate? Here's what He does. He takes servants. He takes people like you and me. Just, I got to tell you, you may be superior. Pastor Jared, just average. I promise you. I was just good enough at sports not to get cut. Y'all know what I mean, don't you? I was just middle of the road in education that I was never last. But let's just be honest. Nobody was asking Jared to give the valedictorian speech. You see, God took an average individual full of anger, full of heartbreak, and full of sin. And He gave him grace. And through Jesus' love of grace in my life, I married above my station. I got two boys that could not claim me because we look alike. And praise God for all the things that He gave us, even in board games. You see, the idea is that He took these individuals as servants and made them rulers. He said, "I'm giving you a little, but now there's so much more, and enter into joy." You are going to be in a position of life in which, if you were really honest with yourselves, you deserve to probably have lived in a ditch. You probably deserved never to be in the station you're at, but because of God's grace and His mercy, He gave you that energy. He gave you that strength. He gave you the wisdom you have. He gave you the abilities, and He certainly taught me, a person who used to be full of anger, how to love. And maybe that's part of your testimony today. Now, I know it's always tempting to look at God as the gotcha type. I think some of us like to look at God that way. But that isn't the case at all. What He wants to show you, what He wants to know, is He wants you to see Him at work in your life. He wants you to see what you've done with the things He's given you. You know, like a child and a parent, I love the children at our church when they run up to show me a picture they did in Sunday school. I love it. I love it when they're in children's church and they want to show us something that they made. Now, let's be honest. I'm not sure that you'll sell any of the things they made at church for millions of dollars. I don't know that. You, as a parent, probably have kept more of them than you want to. I certainly get that. And as grandparents, you treasure every one of them. I get that too. But don't you see, that's the attitude that we have with God our Father? Lord, Lord, let me show you what I did with what you gave me. There's nothing wrong at the end of a sermon to walk up to the altar instead of just going, God, this has been the worst year of my life. There's nothing wrong with walking up going, Lord, you gave me a voice and I sang one time with it. Praise the Lord. There's nothing wrong with going, God, you took my dollar and you stretched it into two. I don't know how you did it, but praise your holy name. God, I don't know how you let this person stay married to me because I have been a real... And I'll let you finish that sentence however you want to. Don't you see? There are moments in our lives where we ought to say, God, thank you for what you did because it could certainly be worse. God wants you to enter into joy. So many a time people have asked, Jared, do you kind of have a theme for next year? Do you have something for next year? Do you have all these things? There was a beautiful picture up there while the choir was singing. Because this is what I'm asking for you to join with me. Now, I know real joy comes when we go to heaven. But I'm ready to enter 2024 with joy instead of sorrow. I'm ready to go to 2024 with the idea that I'm going to be as faithful in whatever God gives me so that He can get all the credit and all the glory. And I'm going to enter into celebrating whatever that is. And I'd like to invite you to join me. I'd like you to have a moment today. We're not done, so stay with me. But I'd like you to have a moment today in which you think real hard, whether you want to bring in all the sin from 23 into 24, whether you'd like to bring all the unforgiveness from 23 into 24, or whether you'd like to bring in all the drama. That's right. There are some people in life, for the absence of drama, they'll create it. Maybe you make a plea to say, you know what, I'd like a drama-less year. And so, Lord, just take control of my ears, my eyes, and my mouth because I already gave you my heart. So having said that, thinking about our friends, if we didn't want them in our lives, if you didn't want a friend to add to your life, you wouldn't have given them anything. You wouldn't have depended on them. But see, if your friend had buried the investment that you made with them, you got to ask yourself again and again if you'd have been happier. You say this morning, well, I'd be happier if they buried it than if they lost it. But you see, that's the risk you take when you put faith into action. And some of you this year, you tried to do some ministry things and it just didn't work. And you've been beating yourself up possibly all year long going, I tried and I failed. I did this and I failed. I thought we were going to do this and we didn't. But you see, that's the risk you take when you put your faith into action. Because if ministry was about you, then what do you need God for? If the results are yours, then what do you need God for? Because you can just do anything, can't you? But that's not what Scripture says. Scripture doesn't say that I can do anything I want because I have all the power. What it does say is that for all the impossibilities of my life with God, all things are possible. It's His strength, not ours. Now, nobody should ever make a movie or write a book about the one person who took the talent and did nothing with it. Worst movie ever. But I love the movie. I love the book where the underdog gets given something and they make double. They do something with it. They make something of themselves. It's something that God does that's uniquely them. And they live and thrive in that attitude. And so I love the idea that you have to step out in faith. Take a risk. Great things come from those steps of faith. Listen, friends, this morning, to those who have been given talent, you might say something clever like, you know, I wouldn't do it. If a friend gave me money to invest for them, I wouldn't do it. I don't want that kind of pressure. You would say, I don't want to lose a friendship. Now, that might seem like a smart thing to say. That might even be a smart thing for you to do, perhaps. I doubt it. And here's why. Because that's exactly what the third servant did. Let's see how it worked out for him. In 24, it said, "Then he who had received one talent came and said, 'Lord, I knew you to be a hard man. You reaped where you have not sown. You gathered where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid. I went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours.' But his Lord answered and said to him, 'You wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown, you gathered where I have not scattered seed, so you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers. At my coming, I would have received back my own with interest. So take the talent from him, give it to him who has 10 talents. Now, I know that can be harsh to hear, but you need to know that worry and fear will keep you from the reward. Every time. You've heard the phrase, no risk and no reward. Why did the last servant do this with the Lord's money? You see, the key phrase is, I was afraid. I was afraid, so I hid. Instead of using the opportunities he'd been given, he buried them. He didn't do evil on purpose. It's not like he sat down, woke up, and met the Lord and said, you know what I'm going to do? I know what he wants. I'm going to do the opposite. What he did, in fact, you might even call cautious. He knew how tough the Lord was. He knew how tough the situation was. He might even be called practical by some. But what you call cautious, Jesus calls lazy. And what you call practical, Jesus calls wicked. What you need to really put into the mind, heart, or soul of you today is this thought, is that too many people haven't served the Lord under the idea of, well, I just don't know if the timing is right. Or too many people have not served the Lord or taken the risk of faith because they'll say, there might be someone better than me. God wouldn't have called you to do it if he didn't want you to do it. Now, the question of whether you do it or not, that's up to you. But by doing nothing, the third servant was committing sin and robbing the Lord of his service and the increase that he expected. Sin, fear, worry, all of these cause us to hide just like Adam and Eve did in the garden. I asked permission to share this little story, so I will. When my children were little and they used to do something wrong, do you know what they used to do? Hide. I didn't teach them to hide. Folks, I didn't even teach them to hide through hide and seek. They may have learned that at church, but I didn't. So when I would come around and be like, boys, I'd hear out of like backwards somewhere, here. I'd have to go looking for them. Why? Because they had hoped that maybe, even though I was temporarily upset at something they did wrong, by the time I found them, I may not be as mad. The only thing is, when I found them later, I've discovered something. I was more mad. Do you get that? When I have to go looking for it, can you imagine the master for just a moment? Here's this guy with 5 and he brings back 10. Here's the guy with 2 and he brings back 4. And then the next guy comes and goes, here's the deal. You're really scary and you're really intimidating. So I dug a hole, see, and I've got all of your money. Don't you worry about a thing. I didn't lose anything." Do you really honestly think that if you pulled a stunt like that at work, where you went to your boss and go, okay, here's the deal. You're a little scary, and I was afraid to lose my job. So all I did was I made sure to hold all the papers. I made sure not to lose any of the contracts or monies or whatever it is you do. I didn't lose any of the supplies. Don't worry. I mean, nothing got done. But the good news is, nothing bad got done. You're welcome. Could you imagine a really upset boss at that point? We've got to ask ourselves. We have our friends. We have investment people, perhaps. But what good is anything that God would give us if we hide and we bury it? When the goal was all the time for us to put it to use. What good did giving money do when you don't use it to be a gain? How would you feel if you sat your family down and you gave them an envelope full of cash and you said, here's the situation, this envelope full of cash. I have got an individual who's going to sit with you, and if you do this right, we can grow this envelope in cash. And then they go, yeah, I'm not really interested. Here, you just take it back. I think I would be insulted if my children just handed whatever I gave them back. That would bother me. Maybe that doesn't bother you, so I'm just preaching to me this morning. But then what good are the gifts of God if we don't share them? You see, this third servant was called unfaithful, and he wasn't rewarded for not losing anything. Let me say that again. You don't get a reward just because you didn't fail. The only people I know in life who haven't failed literally do nothing. And that makes for an unbelievably boring story. You see, this man was afraid that he might fail, so he never tried to succeed. And maybe that's you in 23. Maybe you had one of the roughest years of your life. Or maybe it was the roughest 5 years of your life. But then what did you try? What is it that you tried to push? What risk did you take in the faith? This third servant feared for his life. He was afraid of all the responsibilities. It paralyzed him with anxiety. It paralyzed him with fear. So he buried it to protect it. I want you all to know, and I'm speaking to my own heart, for those of you who struggle, for those of you who have these moments where the pressure is on your chest, the pressure is on your shoulders, one of the worst things that we can do is to crawl into the bed and to not move in hopes that we don't get hurt. For those of you afraid of riding in a car, one of the most interesting situations is when you hear people talk about victory in their life. They'll tell you testimonies. I used to be afraid of flying. I used to be afraid of riding in cars. And what happened is I finally was able to do this thing, and look where I'm at. There was this wonderful little scene in my life in which one of our friends, they were afraid to fly. Their very first flight was to the Bahamas. They had never been anywhere, never done anything. They had only driven. And so they flew to the Bahamas and they took this picture. She is literally waiting with dolphins. And then the smile across her face, if she hadn't have just bought in fully and depended on the Lord fully, she had never got on that plane. I don't care what medicine they gave her. And for those of you who are afraid of those things, you understand exactly what I'm talking about. But she bought in fully to the Lord, and she didn't like it. Don't let me stand up here and tell you that everybody who tries to take this risk, this step of faith, that they go, oh, everything's just perfect, never been happier. It's not like that. What's not written is the moments that the guy with five, the guy with two, what they took to get the gain. You don't know how hard it was for them. You don't know what they had to do. You don't know what trades went on. All you know is that they gave effort. And that's us next year. That's us. So listen to me, church. Some of you are asking right now, I don't know what the talent the Lord is wanting me to put to use. I mean, some of you right now are getting anxious at the thought that you might have already buried it. Or you're wondering, well, if I did go bury it, how do I dig it back up again? Let's make it real simple. Be obedient. Being obedient to God is like depositing your money into a savings account. It's the very least you can do. I gave my boys a hard time. You probably did. Your children, grandchildren, niece, nephews, and cousins. I told them when they were real little, we expect A's in this house. And they looked at me, and without missing a beat, one of them goes, well, did you make straight A's? I said, we're not talking about me. The answer is no, I didn't. But in that context, what we quickly learned is what everybody can do is be obedient to God. It doesn't say what they did to gain the 5 and the 2, but what it does say is that they were both obedient and they both were given the same reward. Being obedient to God is like depositing your money into a savings account. Did you hear that? It means that it's the very least thing that you can do. Obedience. Obedience makes us useful. It gives us a purpose. For all of you are like, I don't know my purpose for 2024. Then be obedient and you'll have one. You say, well, I'm not really satisfied. Last year was awful. I just had a terrible Christmas. New Year's is not looking any brighter. Well, then here's the idea. Be obedient, and only God can bring satisfaction. What does Paul say? I know what it's like to have a lot. I know what it's like to have a very little, but I'm content with whatever I have, which means you can be satisfied day to day, church. And so what else does it bring out to us? Being obedient is easier than you think it is, but it's an act of your will, which means that you have to decide today before you leave that I'm going to be obedient. You know why I know that? Because the servant, the servants, all three, I doubt very seriously that they all woke up and go, today is the day the Lord's coming. I'm really prepared for Him, and I'm going to greet Him, and I'm going to do whatever He wants. I think the Lord showed up. He called them into service, and what came out of their heart was already put in. Which means before you leave this part, we got to get our heart right. We got to get our heart right. Don't wait until you're pressed. When you're pressed, you're probably not going to respond the way you want to. Which means that you'll come back next Sunday and go, dear God, I'm sorry, it was a really bad week, and here's what I did. But I'd like to celebrate with joy next year. And I know that not every day is going to be full of joy. I know that not every day is going to be a good one. But I can decide to work through it. And that's what entering into joy, that's that step of faith. I've used this illustration before, and we're just about finished. But I wonder if you realize how important it is with the concept that God is giving you anything at all. The King of the universe, the only living God, actually came down to be with us. When you entered into a relationship with Him, He filled you with His Holy Spirit. And then He gave you abilities to make a difference in His name. I have favorite sports teams, but not one of them have ever asked my opinion about a trade. I've never had a politician let's say on a national level, pull me into the office and go, well, what do you think about our foreign policy? Never. Never had it. Maybe you have a favorite restaurant. Did that restaurant chain, did they call you to ask you about this next year's change in menu? I doubt it. But the King of the universe has put abilities in you and says, here's how I'd like you to do it. Now go. What are you going to do? And we have a constant back and forth. All right, Lord, I'm going to take this step of faith. What's your thoughts? God, I'm going to do this in your name. I want to praise you. I want to sing a song that brings glory to you. I want to serve you. What is it that is really on your heart? That's the real adage today. Because God is not short on these talents that He gives out. And so you might be considering, what you need to know above all things is you're thinking, well, does God just take stuff away? He's not short on talents, but if you're not going to use it, He'll certainly give it to somebody else who will. So you might be thinking, well, I haven't done this in a long time. I bet you God took it. You know what? He might just have. But I bet you if you ask Him for it again, He'd be willing to give it again. You see, I wonder what people are hiding today. I wonder what step of faith or who in the room would be willing to risk something for a bigger reward. See, the reward part and the reason the man who was given five and gained five was given the other is because God always fulfills His promise that if you're faithful in the small things, He's going to give you more. But see, doing nothing really costs you more than you were willing to lose to begin with. The bottom line, as we head into these next two scriptures and done, is that we're called to live. We're called to be a living sacrifice, not a dead one, and not one who buries their head into the sand. We're called to live. And in 29 it says, "For everyone who has, more will be given, and he'll have an abundance. But from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away, and cast the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Abundance comes from God alone. That's my final point. It'll take me a minute to get through it, but stay with me. Abundance comes from God alone. When you got saved, God gave you plenty of talents, I promise you. For some, He gives five. For some, He gives two. For some, gives one. And then some of you are thinking, "Well, I don't want to be the one. This world has been changed by ones. There's only one Moses. Now, whether he had five, two, or one, there's only one of him. This world was changed by David. It was changed by individuals throughout the Old Testament heading into the new, in which you alone are one creation, and God can use you to change the world." That's right. From our metropolis of Lloyd, we can change the world because God is the one with all the power. And He's willing to use you to do it. But the question is, are you willing to be used? You see, I'll always believe that any increase that you earn is through the power of the Holy Spirit and not just of ourselves. Now, I know it's tempting to give yourself all the credit for whenever you do something. But you see, you gained whatever you gained off the talent He gave you to begin with. And for each and every one of us, we ought to end 23, heading into 24, with the attitude that, "God, everything I have is yours, and everything I gain is because of you." The joy of the Lord is mentioned in this parable because it's a blessing to see God use us. But why is this such a hard teaching? Because a life full of fear becomes useless, and I want to be useful. I want my life to have mattered. I want the things that I say and do, don't you, to make a difference in this world? Therefore, if I'm full of fear, if I do nothing, then there's no reward. And this kind of fear can keep us from sowing the seeds of the gospel that Jesus wanted us to. And I have to ask you, is that you today? Has last year, the last 3 years, 5 years, has it been so full of fear, whether it's health or finances or anything in between, that has kept you from doing what you know God wants you to do? And so what is it that you haven't done because of fear? There's no profit in that. You see, church, we often look at life as risk versus reward. But I'm telling you today as a Christian that your life is a risk just for walking, and that without taking some risks in your faith, you won't have a reward. And so for all of you who say, "God, I just want you to bless me," then I have to ask you, well, then what was your step of faith? Is there a particular area that you want to be blessed, or do you just want God to spray paint blessings? Because let me tell you, when it comes to my life, I have very specific requests on my heart. But because of His grace and mercy, He has a wide area of blessings. No risk, no reward, no abundance. Now, if we obey Him, it means we love Him. If we don't obey Him, Truth is, it means that we don't really love Him. At least not as much as we tell people we do. If our hearts are not invested in His teaching, then we probably won't follow Him. I know a lot of people that agree with all kinds of things I say. The real question is, will they do what the Bible says? Love and obedience actually go hand in hand. Folks, you cannot earn His love. You can't do it. But you can't really love Him without being obedient. So the greater the obedience, the greater you're going to need to risk next year. The greater the risk, the greater your reward will be. Now, it's possible for some of you to read this scripture and think, well, that last servant, he wasn't saved. Or maybe some of you read it and you say, well, he lost his salvation because he didn't do what God wanted him to. Perhaps you've read it that way for years. First of all, the Bible teaches that you can't lose your salvation. But it's dangerous to build your entire theology just on a parable. But this parable illustrates absolute truths in our lives, is that Jesus used this parable to expand our mind. In this case, what you need to know is this third servant, he was a servant. You see, Jesus offers salvation to everybody, but he only gives ability to those who are his. The outer darkness, and this is where we'll wrap this up, doesn't always refer to Hades and hell, even though that's often the case. Let me explain. This outer darkness meant that this man was dealt with by the Lord. I hate getting disciplined. I hate doing anything wrong. That bugs me. Every single time a principal ever called me into the office, I immediately assumed it was because I did something wrong. I know that wasn't always the case, but that's the first direction I go. And the reason I express it that way is this outer darkness, because he was dealt with by the Lord, it means that he lost this opportunity for service and he gained no praise and no reward. And to me, that is the outer darkness. I'll never be separate from God's love, but I can be separated from His blessing, and I don't want to carry that into 2024. So I know that saying that this morning, some of you are thinking, well, I don't know about that. I promise you it's the same thing for when you got in trouble in school. You remember when your parents said no car for the weekend? Remember when your parents put you on restriction and said you can't go anywhere? Do you remember when your parents kept you from doing something you wanted to do because of something you did? No obedience. No blessing. The hard teaching in that is it's possible that this one talented man who thought his talent wasn't really important, and because he didn't have five talents or because he didn't have two or whatever it is, why even worry about the one? You listen, if that's you this morning, those ones change the world. I'm a one. But I'm not that one. I'm whatever God wants me to be. Are you a two? Do you know what's expected of you? Are you a five? Do you know what's expected of you? It's okay to be a one. It's not okay to be that one. And today, as we close, this is what you are called to do. I want to enter in next year with joy. And I no longer want to be that one. I don't want to hide. I don't want to bury. I don't want to be so afraid of risking something that I don't see the challenging reward and the blessing that goes with it. For some of you, the real challenge this year, that step of faith, is going to be reading the Bible all the way through. For some of you, the challenge would be reading just one book a month, whatever that book is. We're just going to read that one book. For some, it could be sharing your testimony next year. You want to talk about what Jesus has done in your life. For some, it's called to teach a class. Join the choir. Hold the door open and make sure that the person who's walking in the door, that they are welcome to know Jesus at this place. For some of you, it's going to be cooking a meal, praying a prayer. Whatever that calling is, the ability is there. Will you do it? Is this the year that you say, enough is enough? I'm going into 2024 with this attitude. Whatever God you give me, I'm going to be faithful, but I'm going to take the risk. I wondered, for all of you who read this section of Scripture and said, well, I don't know if they're saved or not. Are you? Are you a saved soul? Meaning, do you really believe that Jesus gave his life willingly for you so that you could be forgiven for not just all the big sin in life, but for every sin you've ever done? Did you call on his name to save you? And if you did, then here's this other thought this year. Are you a saved soul but a wasted life? I don't want to be that guy. I want to have purpose and meaning in Jesus. Don't you? I don't want to waste another year of my life. Because in truth, I don't know how many more we have, do you? And so this morning I invite you, if you don't know who Jesus is, I invite you to come forward. I invite you just to say, hey, listen, I don't know who Jesus is, or I thought I did, I clearly don't. I want a brand new life today. If you know Jesus intimately, you've experienced his grace, but you feel like you wasted last year. You feel like you wasted this whole process of things, or you wasted a week. Then let this be the year that you go, okay, here it is, God. Come forward to the altar. Spend a moment. Don't stay in the same seat in the same way. You'll probably enter in next year the same direction. Let this be the year that you grab your wife, your husband, your children, your grandchildren, niece, nephews, and cousins, whoever it is, and pull them aside and say, Jesus loves you. I love you. I'm forgiving you for all that you said and did. I want Jesus' forgiveness in my life. I want you to forgive me. I no longer want a wasted life. I want this year to be the year of the Lord. It's time to enter into joy. Will you join me? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we've had some joy-filled moments in the past, but we'd like for this next year to be just you. We know doing your ways, your will and your timing, God, that joy can be complete. And so until you come back and get us real soon, let this be the year which we come to know you and that our life is changed forever. So deal with our hearts now. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand? Would you come?
Infinite wisdom, who can fathom
folks, if you don't mind being seated for just one more moment, we've got a wonderful moment here. I want to introduce you to Tina. Many of you have met her. You've known her. She gave her heart to Jesus. She's been baptized, but she's coming forward today to unite in fellowship with us. And so God's got a new calling on her life. Now, what that will be through here, time will tell. So, everybody, this is Tina. I promised I wouldn't embarrass her the way I embarrassed Paulette. But in that context, all in favor of Tina coming to join us today, would you raise a hand? I never asked for no's. So welcome to our faith family, okay? Folks, we're going to go into the back, and we're just going to, you can greet us and go different places. But as we do, let's say a prayer of Tina, and I ask a blessing on all of you this coming up year. Would you bow your heads? Father in heaven, we love you, and we thank you for Tina coming to join us today. May you bless her. Bless those today that made commitments to you. Bless their family and their friends. God, thank you for this worship moment. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Goodbye, everybody.